and whippoorwill call. And even if night, I hurry to my blue heaven. You turn to the right, you find a little bright light that leads you to my blue heaven. You find a cozy place, higher place, cozy road. Orderliness, deadness is where the roses bloom. Just Molly and me, and a baby make free. Be happy in my blue heaven.
As writers, we're participating in a market that now is demanding austerity.
Now, can I interrupt you for a moment?
Please.
Because I think it's the politicians that demand austerity, not so much the market. You know, the funny thing about the market is, if you claim to be an expert, you say, I'm an economist, I studied at the University of Chicago, I know everything about the market, and I'm going to tell you what these markets are telling us. Many people will believe you. So the politicians claim that austerity is going to work for us. Many economists disagree. Among them, Paul Krugman, who writes a daily, writes a column for the New York Times, won a Nobel Prize. He says that austerity is going to, well, kill us is maybe a too big, but it's going to hurt us. And if you look at Ireland, where they followed all the advices, they didn't get the payback yet. So it's very debatable whether the markets demand austerity, or some people in the political system think, for whatever reason, that austerity is going to be the right medicine.
What I'm finding right now is that we don't know what these markets, these invisible hands, other than them being hungry, are going to do right now.
We are the markets. If people, when you speak about the market or the people, of course, that's us also. If heaven is already here, we cannot feel it anymore. You need to have the feeling that there's transgression, that you commit a sin. I think that's part of the pleasure, and that's also part of the capitalist principle, that the moment we buy something, we know we cannot afford. And I do it myself often. I mean, I became in that way American. I have 5 credit cards, and I juggle around these credit cards in order to keep my lifestyle going. So, and we know it's sinful to buy something you don't have the money for yet, but still you do it. And part of the enjoyment is not only the product you're buying, whatever it is, but it's also the knowing that you're doing something you're not supposed to do. Yeah, we took a liking to each other, I think, the first time we met.
What do you think? What happened?
I think that's something that happens intuitively. I think it's the same with when you see somebody and you dislike the person, or it's not. I don't think that's a very conscious process.
I know why we like each other. We both live on Park Avenue.
Well, I live
like
close
the Christmas trees.
Yes, maybe that's
the same
that's
Christmas
it.
Trees.
Yes.
The lights.
That could be, or the fact, I mean, that we both moved to a place where we weren't born, voluntarily. Yes.
I never can get you on the telephone. I mean, I call you and call you.
Yeah. But
you're always very busy, but you're very, very, what should we say? What do you do during the day? I can't get in touch with you.
That's,
I mean, what do you do?
I feel a bit guilty now that you don't get me on the phone, but it's not that I don't pick up the phone, but usually when I'm working, I try to switch off the phone. And during the day, I mean, I have like, of course, I mean, as every author knows, and that's something you know also, I mean, writing is also, it's not only waiting for inspiration, it's a matter of discipline, especially when you write a novel. I mean, a novel is thick. So you sit down, and you have working hours, like anybody who goes to an office. And I don't go to an office because I work in my kitchen. Jill Protterwan is 54. He has 3 children, 2 sons of 17 and 14, and a 9-year-old daughter. He had felt that 2 children were more than enough, but his wife really wanted a little girl. To keep a marriage running, sacrifices must be made. So what's this American's name? Something like Limeson, I think. Limeson. Never heard of him, the professor said. Vatterwein and his family live in Badenweiler. That's about a 45-minute drive from his office in Basel. His specialism is neuropsychiatry, and he does research for Novartis into medicines for the illness still referred to popularly as schizophrenia. Jules Poitevin, son of a French father and a Flemish mother, studied at Utrecht and made a name for himself with a pioneering study of automutilation among adolescents. At his recommendation, the European Union at the time had declared war on automutilation. The urge to carve up one's own body had spread like a virus.
Everyone has been very, very, very nice to us. And see you downstairs and see you next year.
Tak my pijem na budoucnost.
A toast to the future.
Baby, make free, be happy in mind, be careful.